Hi everyone, it's that time of the fortnight again. It's time for back chat. I'm Amy, this is Maggie. Together we are ThinkerThemer. In this series, we spend a lot of money and we talk you through our top 10 crowdfunding campaigns for the previous fortnight. So leading up to today, when we launch this video,
still hopefully
on Monday.
Active. Yes.
Which are hopefully still active. So play along if you like and back responsibly.
Yes.
But before we get into our top 10, today there are two different campaigns that I'd just like to give a shout out to. Two things that we've found particularly interesting but are not necessarily games. The first is the Meeple Light. How cool is this Meeple Light?
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
If you've ever wanted a Meeple that lights up and goes all different colors to have, maybe you're creating content to put in your background, or maybe you just want some ambience when having your friends over for a game night.
Have a very stunning game bookshelf.
You can change the color of
the
eye. And if you've never wanted a meeple that lights up, well, they have meeples that don't light up as well. And there was an early bird on this, and so I jumped in on that. And the one reason that I'm backing this is the Christmas tree.
Yeah.
How amazing to have a meeple on top of the Christmas tree.
The little adapter so you can put it as your guiding star at the top of your Christmas tree.
Yeah. I feel like it sends a subtle message about what I want for Christmas.
And what we're about.
I want for Christmas. You're very subtle.
Extremely
very
subtle.
All I want for Christmas is
only
more board
every
games.
Neighbor will be able to see it and know.
Or not know, as the case may be. If you're like, why is there
what is that?
Slightly wide
bus. Do they have a strange person? That makes no sense.
Anyway, our friends will love it. So I'm excited about that. That is Meeple Light. The other one is the extraordinarily talented illustrator, Beth Sobel.
Yes.
Has created her own deck of cards called the River and Stone playing cards. So those are live on Kickstarter now and they are just absolutely gorgeous.
Of course. It's Beth Sobel.
Of course. Everything she does is gorgeous. Yes. And we'll be talking more about her gorgeous artwork later on in this episode, but go and check out her cards. She's doing exceptionally well, which is amazing. And I know because she was posting updates on working through. She's been working on these for such a long time. So if you need a new set of playing cards, you can always have more playing cards.
Yeah.
So go and check out that campaign too. Yeah. And now we'll get into our top 10.
So starting with our number 10 is a game called One Deck Galaxy, which is by the same people who brought you One Deck Dungeon, which is a very well-loved game. We've never played it because dungeons.
Well, yeah, and also it's cooperative, solo or cooperative, so that counts me out.
Yeah.
But it's dungeon crawling as well. So
which counts me out.
Yeah.
So usually.
But it has had wonderful reviews and people really love it as a solo game in particular.
Yeah. So this one essentially is galaxy themed and it's apparently fairly similar, but they've made some improvements to the overall sort of mechanics of how the game plays.
Yeah. Sorry, I was going to say my understanding is that they've tried to make it so that the dice are more useful if you get an unlucky roll.
Yeah, yeah. So there's always something that you can do. But thematically, you're going to be, it sounds like essentially building your civilization in space. And there's a couple, the tension is between either building up your strength based on, you know, obviously the pool of dice that you roll, or using those dice to fight an adversary. So you've got all these different adversaries and they all have different abilities or different powers in that kind of unique way of fighting them.
And so you're working your way through a deck, hence the One Deck Galaxy, and you're finding different encounters or different locations. And then you're able to, I think if you meet their conditions, you can slide them under your player board. So I like some of the mechanics look really cool.
Yeah.
I don't know. The galaxy is not really an improvement on dungeons for me. I found it. And also reading the rule book, it was very thematically written. And I struggle so much with that. I really trying to work out how to play the game. I struggle with it because I don't really understand terminology to do with space and galaxies. But other people will probably really love and thrive on that.
Yeah.
That is our number 10 of the week, of the fortnight.
Of the fortnight, yeah.
One Deck Galaxy.
Our number 9 is a game called The Stuff of Legends, based on the graphic novel by the same name, which I actually happen to have right here.
Which has won a lot of awards.
Yes, so this is a very, very highly celebrated graphic novel series, I believe. I only have the first one because Amy purchased it or provided it for me or obtained it from, I don't know what I'm saying. But in this game, the stuff of legends, it takes place in 1944. It's in Brooklyn and it's sort of happening obviously alongside the war. And it sort of starts out with this little boy and all of his toys. The little boy gets abducted by the boogeyman. And so the toys, Toy Story style, are going to come to life and go and rescue the boy, which via their the closet, which, as we all know, is where the boogeyman comes and goes
from. Of course. From.
Yes. And so, and in the game, obviously, what we're going to be doing is we're playing as the toys. Mm-hmm. And so we've got all the sort of different asymmetric abilities. Mm-hmm. And we're going to be making our way through the different paths, trying to find our way out of the darkness to go and rescue the boy.
And so the idea with the game is that there are multiple exits, I believe, and you're trying to find the right exit using deduction. So as a group, it's a cooperative experience. You're going to be looking at these little tokens that are going to give you more information about what might be the right or wrong path out of the closet. I should be pretty good at that. I spent my whole life kind of coming out of the closet. Anyway.
Out of the darkness.
Out of the darkness, sorry. But you are exiting. And if you can exit the game, there's a little twist in the game where there's also a hidden traitor, or there can be a hidden traitor, who is working with the boogeyman and not the boy. And I also believe that that allegiance can change throughout the course of the game. So you will be swapping roles as well. So you're never quite sure who's working for you or against you. I really liked one element of the game, which is the way that the boogeyman can use his, army to attack you is based on the amount of noise that you're making. So there's a little kind of tracker of how much noise you're making when you're moving around. And then that kind of dictates how many of his army are going to be attacking you. Mm. I thought it was kind of fun to include this like deduction, hidden traitor, all of these elements together. But ultimately, it's cooperative, so it's rated a little lower by us. I really wanted to check out this game. As soon as I heard about it, I was way more excited about it. And then when I read the campaign, actually my excitement kind of went down a little, just because it's not really our style of game. Yeah. But I was really intrigued because, you know, the graphic novel is so popular, and also just kind of, I like that, like, in parallel with the war, like the boy fighting his own kind of war idea. Like
the toys, going for that rescue mission or like fighting the evil. I think one of the other downsides, it's a three to six players, so it's not something that you could play in a small player count. It reminded me a lot of, and I don't know if this is correct, but it reminded me a lot of Saboteur, where you have obviously some of those like hidden traitor roles, and then there's going to be peeking to see like which path is the correct path, which is one of the things that you kind of do in Saboteur, and then you kind of go, oh, we definitely want to go this way or that way.
Yes.
And then it's like, no, you know, he's a traitor.
Don't trust them.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. So I think this is obviously a much more decked out version, with all obviously following all of the imagery of the graphic novel, obviously, so the illustrations are going to be like top notch alongside of the aesthetic of the graphic novel.
Yeah, and it looks like a beautiful production, like there are miniatures and everything, so if you're into that, if you're into co-op and a little bit of deduction and kind of intrigue, go and check that.
I'm usually not a big fan of like the hidden traitor roles, because I get so anxious, and I hate it when I'm a traitor. I'm lucky that I often am not, but I just don't like feeling like that. So
you don't like the pressure on you.
Yeah.
And you can always tell, because when you are the bad guy, you become really like uncomfortable.
Yeah. I'm like worst poker face ever.
And yet when you're like Merlin in Avalon, you're like all full of confidence.
Yeah, like, so again, worst poker face ever.
Worst. But that is our number 9, The Stuff of Legend. Our number 8 is a game called Critical Care. And in this game, again, it's cooperative, and you are playing as a team of doctors who are looking after patients in the intensive care unit. And this game operates the way you think an intensive care unit would operate. Mm-hmm. You each have a patient, and those patients are going to be incurring injuries. They're going to be having complications through the cards that you're drawing. And ultimately, you want to treat those patients and get them back to a fit bill of health.
So in this game, one of the things that I really appreciated is that it's not just the element of, you get paid to start your day, and then you kind of look at what complications did they have overnight while I haven't been, you know, here looking after them or whatever. It's that they also, they engage a clinical researcher and a patient advocate to make sure that there's a human element, or that the human element of what it's like, or some of those decisions that you're having to make, is captured. And almost like, and so the patients are not just like this faceless token. It's like they're very much, you kind of, you see the human side of it. So I think that'll even highlight the, like, almost the ethical choices if you're having to decide, you know, well, who gets treatment and who doesn't, because we have limited resources.
And this was actually designed by a doctor.
Yes, which an is ICU doctor. So there's going to be a lot of credibility in terms of the thematic elements, hopefully.
Yeah. And in collaboration with Amaria Kill, who is obviously a really well-respected game designer, who did Hoop Gods and Rap Gods. And together they've put together this experience that is really interesting to me, in that it is very close to the truth of medical conditions. So they don't shy away from using medical language. And that language is then, it comes with kind of a booklet that explains that medical language. So that it's almost like educational, because the complications that, if you pick up a complication, depending on your current state of play with your patient, i.e. what other conditions does that patient have, it's going to be better or worse for that patient. And so that is interesting and very true to real life. For me, the theme is a little too close to real life, if I'm honest. And I guess games, in a way, are a bit of an escape at the moment, like thinking about hospitals and things. I totally respect they've done this with, all of, in the best kind of way. They've treated this subject like,
Very respectfully, and obviously very credibly as well.
But I guess it's just an uncomfortable place for me to sit. And you said that, you know, with the fact that they're bringing in the human element of the characters in the game. So like this character who's really sick as an artist and that type of thing. And with their hopes and dreams for the future. I'm quite empathetic as a person, and that would be
very difficult.
I think that would be like just not a good time for me.
So I think for me, I I'm intrigued by it, because again, they say that you don't need any medical knowledge to play the game well, because it's all the iconography and all of that is should be fairly straightforward. And if anything, it's like you're going to be learning things from medical kind of terminology and things like that. But I think I'm curious to see, obviously having, like, working in the healthcare industry, how much of it I'm like, oh yeah, I can sort of see what they were going with that. But by and large, it's not the theme that I gravitate towards, again, because it doesn't feel like an escape. It's like, oh well, this is kind of work,
this
life.
Is serious.
And it's serious. Exactly.
But
I mean, it is helpful to, again, if you're in the right headspace, or if you're attracted to those sorts of themes, then it's going to be, you're gonna get to experience that theme and learn a little bit about it, and learn, you know, well, what's it really like? What are some of the other tougher decisions aside from just, well, who gets what? It's like, you know, how do you choose?
I really like that this topic's being treated respectfully, and that a doctor is actually behind the design. So that is all really great. Probably not a game for it. It's also cooperative, so that kind of rules us out. The game, I think, is just above $50. The postage to Australia, sorry to, if you're not in Australia, for me to always comment on this, but they gave a range of prices between $20 and $35 US. At $20 US, it's expensive but fair. At $35, it's like, kind of eye-wateringly expensive. Not to say that that's not the truth of what's going on in the world at the moment with shipping, but it just makes kind of these types of games a bit like difficult to justify. When hopefully it will make it to retail. You can get it at retail. But anyway, that is our number 8, Critical Care, the game.
Our number 7 is a game called Pirate Party, Women of the High Seas. So this is a cute little card game, which we actually covered as part of Small Talk. So we'll obviously, like, imagine you'll link to it, and you can check out the more of an explanation and sort of our thoughts about it. But in this game, we all are, it's a card game. So we're going to be playing in sets of either suited sets or three of a kind types of sets. The sets that we're going to be making are the crew of a ship, and we have a lot of different female female pirates that are actually women pirates throughout history. So these are actually historically accurate personalities, and you get to learn a little bit about them. And there's even more information about them on the campaign page and obviously on the website as well. But the way that you're going to be playing this is you're going to be, as you're playing these different sets, you can also match sets that have been played by your opponents. And the game can end of a few different ways, but at the end of game, you're going to either get all the points that you've played in front of you, but you're also going to minus any points that you end up in your hand. Mm-hmm. So there's this sort of tension of, you know, playing cards to your player area, knowing that there are going to be some cards that have sort of different actions in them that allow opponents to steal your cards.
Adventure cards, and they are chaos.
They can be, yes.
And what, that favorite card, though?
There's one card that I love because it would upset you so much every time. The Hurricane, which, you know, you might be working really hard at putting together your hand so you can play all these sets, and all of a sudden, you know, I would play the Hurricane, which is you mix both of your hands together and you reshuffle them out, or you redistribute them out.
I think it was worse for me because I get very like, oh, I don't want to put my cards down because I don't want you to steal them. So I had a lot of good sets in my hand, and every time that Hurricane got me,
and every time I would get it, I'd be like, oh, here it is. Your favorite card.
Yeah. And actually, the designer does say that if you are not a fan of Take That, you can take out the adventure card. So it makes it a bit more of a fair, even playing field. Yeah. But I really liked that part of the game because it is, at the end of the day, like, you know, just kind of like this.
It's a light.
It's a really light card game where you're making quite simple sets and things. And so it's the chaos that kind of brings the energy and the fun to the game. A really great little filler. Mm. The designer, female designer, which, you know, we always like to get behind, but also she designed this because she was out of work due to COVID. And I just think it's like such a creative theme to go and research, you know, the female pirates that are not often spoken about.
And quite diverse. So a diverse range was from female pirates across the history and across different areas of the globe.
So if you want more information on that game, go and check out our episode of Small Talk. But otherwise, that is our number 7 pirate party, Women of the High Seas. Our number 6 is a really interesting campaign, and we both gave it 6, number 6, and we both gave it 6, average of 6. And this game is not really a game, but it's a deck of cards, and it is a professional Japanese Hanafuda deck. And I went down the biggest rabbit hole because of this campaign, because I looked at this campaign and I was like, wow, what is Hanafuda? I don't know what that is. And then they started describing this game called Hachi Hachi or 88. I think it's called 88 in America. And I was like, oh, I've never, like, what is different about these cards? And then when you read the campaign, they were talking about the design of these cards and how they were trying to take a regular Hanafuda deck and turn it into something that was a bit more kind of introductory friendly. And they used this beautiful mandala effect on the card. So the graphic design or the illustration on these cards were just so beautiful that it absolutely had me intrigued. And then I went down this huge rabbit hole of what are these games? And so for those of you who don't know, a Hanafuda deck is what's called, a flower deck. And it's really, obviously it came from Japan, but it's really common in Japan and Korea and other Southeast Asian countries where they all have different versions or slightly different versions of games that they play with this deck. And the way that it's different from a regular deck of cards is that there are 12 suits, each representing a month in the calendar year. And within each of those month suits, there are 4 cards, and those 4 cards piece together a panorama. And what was really interesting is, like, going back through a very light, like, rabbit hole into the history of this deck, way back when in Japan, where gambling, they were trying to outlaw gambling with these card games. And it started off like more like a regular deck of cards with numbers. And what happened over time is that every deck of cards would get banned by the government. And so a new deck would pop up, and eventually it got more and more abstract to the point where it was just like images so that it wasn't really easily identifiable as like a gambling game. And I just thought that was so fascinating. I think there has been a little bit of taboo around the particular cards that are used in Japan and the original decks and things like that, because it's a little bit associated with the Yakuza. And so the games themselves have been a bit taboo. But I think now, second fun fact, Nintendo started by making these Hanafuda decks. I had no idea about that fact. And they still make them today.
So before video games,
they started the company, the owner started the company to really print these high quality Hanafuda decks.
Right.
Then went into video games, but still producing these Hanafuda decks. And so now it's really common to find Mario themed or any kind of Nintendo Zelda themed decks of Hanafuda cards. So, that is a long story to get to this particular campaign, which started that rabbit hole and taught me a lot more about this game, Hachi Hachi. But also there's a game called Koi Koi, which I believe is a Japanese two-player game that's meant to be a bit easier and, you know, a lot of fun to play with one of these special decks of cards. And then there is a Korean game as well that is really common in Korea. And so, anyway, long story short, I actually went down a rabbit hole with this campaign, backed the campaign, then didn't back the campaign because I'm thinking I'm going to get a Nintendo deck.
Oh, no.
I know. So this, so I went like campaign full
like
circle.
Inspired you to like look into it.
I feel bad about that. So maybe I will back these cards as well. Oh. But definitely I want to like learn the history of these card games and learn them. Like, we don't play too many card games, like regular card games. Obviously we love Teachu, but it's very hard to play it with four players. One of these games, 88, I believe you need to have it like ideally three people. So that,
right.
But I guess we could
tricky.
If we have a card game for every player count.
That is less so viable. Like,
there's exactly six of us. Well, do I have a card game for you?
I think one thing that you mentioned, though, at one point was that there's a challenge, like there's almost like a learning curve in terms of understanding with the regular decks, the ones that fit together.
Yes.
And so you kind of have to learn how that works. And so with this deck, it's making it easier so that you don't have
to. Exactly. Yep.
And then one concern was, is this going to almost like de-skill you?
Because now
you're going to be used to using this deck that kind of lends, like guides you by the hand, which is better and easier as a beginner. But then if you go and play with one of the other decks, you're going to be like, I'm completely lost.
When I, through my research, when I was looking at all these other decks of cards, they all seem to follow like a similar pattern, even though they're using different illustrations, because there is, for example, a lot of the months have one card that has a ribbon on it, and a ribbon card does certain things. And then there's like these junk or trash cards, which are worth fewer points within each of the months. And then it gets really confusing from there. So this is going to be a steep learning curve, but I'm intrigued. And now I want a Nintendo set of cards.
As well.
And I might still get my these beautiful cards because they are so beautiful, these mandala cards. So if you already have a set of Hanafuda cards and you want to check out that campaign, go and check it out. They're really stunning. That is our number six, professional Japanese Hanafuda deck.
Now to our number five. Our number five is a game called Dog Park. Now, this is a topic that is very near and dear to my heart.
It sure is.
I'm one of those dog crazy people. And in this game, we play as dog walkers. And so we're trying to get the most victory points by being the most popular or the highest reputation dog walker. And the way that we get that popularity is by taking our puppies for a walk to the local dog park and making sure that they are happy, that we give them the right treats and we bring the right toys to make them kind of give us their Walker's Choice Award. I made that up. But yeah, essentially, the happier we made, the more we match their preferences, the more points we're going to get. There's 163 unique cards with like beautiful watercolor illustrations of every single dog breed. And so that's, I think, going to make for a beautiful table presence. In terms of how you actually play, it almost reminded me a bit of Parks, because you're kind of the hiking track in Parks, because as you're walking along, you can either speed through and be, you know, kind of get to the end first and almost kind of trigger the end of that round. But then you might miss out on some of your doggy's favorite mm-hmm. treats and things along the way. Or, you know, you might kind of be taking your time, but then end up not making it home.
And you get a penalty. Yeah. You get a penalty if you don't make it back.
So you have that balance. The components, like the added like little, the treats and the toys, so cute.
So cute. Everything is so beautiful about yes. this game. There yeah. are a couple of things that I really like about it. There is auction bidding in the game. So mm. you're going to be bidding to add kind of the dog cards to your player board. Mm. And the way that that gets chosen is obviously the highest bidder for each of the dogs, but you're bidding with your victory points, which is a really mm. interesting idea. Do you take a less optimal dog and bid less, or do you go for it and kind of risk that those victory points that you can make them back?
There's no less optimal dog. As I said, like all dogs are high optimal to my heart.
According to the resources that you have on yeah. hand, I would imagine.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then the ones that you choose to take to walk, you mm. have to have the right resources, as you mentioned. I really like that about the game. And I do like that almost like kind of rondelle style of like moving along mm-hmm. the track to, mm-hmm. you know, trying to race ahead or yeah. go slow, but with a little bit of a penalty.
Yeah.
I really liked that as well. I really like the game trays that come with it. I believe with the collector's edition of the game, this is one of those games where I believe the standard edition and the collector's edition don't really need to exist because mm. there's such a small difference in price. I think it's about mm. $15 between wow. The standard and the collector's, and the collector's just has so much more.
Beautiful, yeah.
And the component trays are dog bones. Mm-hmm. So cute. I love them. And it also comes with two expansions with the collector's edition. So there is a famous dogs pack. And then there's also the European dogs pack. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that is really, really cool. And obviously in this type of game, mm. the more dogs, the better, because when you're playing with, and this is why I would want to back this game and why we are backing this game, is because I think this is a really nice gateway, level
yeah.
game.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And who doesn't love dogs? Exactly. Or a lot of people in our lives love dogs who are just yeah. kind of getting into board games. And so I just think it's a really beautiful theme that hasn't yeah. been done like a lot in
yeah.
the hobby.
Yeah.
And it will really draw people in with all the...
And it's done beautifully in yeah. terms of, yeah, the table presence. So, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So I think the collector's edition, yeah, it's only 15. I think they might end up getting rid of the standard edition mm. and their pledges yeah, because yeah. it's just... Everyone's going for the collector's
edition. Why wouldn't you go edition.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's about... I think it was $30 shipping-ish, and so mm-hmm. it works out to be about $100. And it does look like a really high production mm. game that yeah. Hopefully all of our friends will enjoy.
Mm.
But that is our number 5, Dog Park.
And number 4 is a game called The Light in the Mist. Now, this is a character-driven, story-driven puzzle game using a tarot deck.
I'm really excited about this.
Yeah, beautifully illustrated, unique, mm-hmm. I think 78 cards, mm-hmm. Uniquely illustrated and like sort of really beautiful as
Stunning.
Well. Stunning. And it's by a team that has been making, we haven't actually played any of their games before, mm-hmm. but it's the sense that I get is that this is kind of like a multiple escape rooms in a box. Because it's like a 5-hour plus experience.
Mm-hmm.
But essentially what's happened in this game is our friend Sam has disappeared and we've got a series of her items that will help us kind of piece together her memories and hopefully will mean that then we can kind of find our way to her and rescue her or mm-hmm. figure out what happened.
And one of those items is the tarot deck.
Oh, right. Well, then that yeah. makes sense. Yeah.
yeah. So the tarot deck, each card has clues that will help you with more than one of the puzzles that are contained in like a book. I really thought it was interesting that they called this game a puzzle tale because mm. it's part narrative, part puzzle. It's like, I guess you could imagine an escape room in a box, but with more narrative.
Mm.
And you will be reading from this book. What's also interesting about this game is that it's not linear.
Mm.
So you can choose which puzzles you do at what time, and overall you're going to be completing them all. But when you work out one puzzle, it's going to help you kind of work out that you don't need that part of the card anymore mm. for the next set of puzzles. So the book is going to direct you which cards you need to take out. Then you're going to work out what is the common theme. And I believe then there's a word. Mm-hmm. So it will like lead you to a word that then you look up to see if you've like
yes, if you've
worked
got
out
that.
The puzzle.
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah. And so I don't know, I found it really fascinating, but I just love the effort that's gone into integrating these puzzles into the most beautiful deck of tarot cards.
Yeah.
I like that you're not destroying anything, because once we're finished with the game, we can like give it to some friends to also work their way through. And yeah, I just really thought it was kind of cool. Obviously, it's a bit of a co-op experience, but we do like escape rooms in a box.
You tend to not mind co-op when it's a puzzle room. Yeah.
I just like, yeah, that's true. I do like puzzles and working things out like that.
I guess because as you've said before, like you can still kind of figure it out before me.
Exactly.
So you still kind of feel like,
I got it. Don't worry, babe. I got this.
Got this.
So that is The Light in the Mist. It works out to be about $80 Australian delivered, including the base level pledge. Looking at the pledge options, I would only opt for the base level. It feels like there's not a lot of gameplay additions in kind of the higher levels. So for me, that is kind of the value buy. And it seems really reasonably priced for everything that you're getting. It is really beautiful. So that is our number four, The Light in the Mist. Our number three is Verdant. Verdant?
Verdant.
Verdant. Fun fact, what's Verdancy mean?
I know verde is green in Spanish, so I'm imagining from the Latin root, it's probably something to do with greenery.
Green. It is. It's like the lush vibrancy of flourishing vegetation is something is the official definition. I didn't even know what that meant. I had never heard this word before. And all through, obviously, the gameplay, they're talking about verdancy. I'm like, what is that? So I looked it up and games just teach me so much.
Yeah.
So anyway, in this game, this is by the same team, Flat Out Games, who brought you Cascadia and Calico, two games that I personally absolutely adore. Spatial puzzles, kind of really thinky puzzles that have low rules overheads, but are still really difficult. Love it.
With a beautiful table presence.
Oh, beautiful table presence. And here she is again, Beth Sobel, creating all of these unique plant cards, because in this game, you are going to be decking out a house with house plants. And each of these plant cards are unique and give you information about that plant. And I'm just like, I'm so surprised this theme, along with Dog Park, hasn't been done before, because I know so many people like indoor plants so hot right now, especially during lockdown, because what else can you tend to?
Grow stuff inside.
We're not very good at keeping plants alive.
We do not have green thumbs at
all. I did learn that watering them helps. That is as far as I've gotten.
To be fair, we don't water neglect, or if that's even a thing. I think if anything, in the early stages, we overwatered them.
I think we go from extreme to extreme, to be honest. Probably we are very like, let's water them too much and then too little. So anyway, back to the game. So in this game, you're going to be drafting cards similar to the style that you draft tiles in Cascadia, except for you get to choose between two different types of cards in this instance, either rooms or plants. And when you select the room or plant, you also have to take a tile. So you are locked into taking that same tile in the column. And then you're going to be placing it in a 5x3 grid in front of you, which represents your house. And in your house, you have to be alternating rooms and plants. So you can never put two plants together or two rooms together.
Just like in real life. If you put two plants side by side, forget about it. Yeah. Two rooms side by side, forget about it.
Anyway, you're in your theme. And then you are also going to be looking at the lighting conditions required by those plants and the lighting conditions given by the rooms that they are adjacent to in order to earn bonus points by way of verdancy. And these verdancy tokens, ultimately you're going to be able to spend them to put your plants in these really, really cute little pots. So cute.
Componentry, again, like table presence of this is going to be beautiful. The little components, the little green leaves, and even the little pot holders. Like all of that looks really cute. I think, again, like knowing it's a team that has historically had great production quality with everything that they've done, I think it's gonna just sit really nicely with those two other games that we've got and we've enjoyed.
This is almost a no-brainer for me. This I would almost back this without you telling me anything about the campaign, because I love the other two games so much. And I have, you know, reviewers have said that this kind of sits in the middle between in terms of crunchiness between the two.
Yeah, because Calico's like, oh, brain hurts. And Cascadia's like, oh, this is nicer, but yeah, still, so it still has, yeah,
in the middle,
intellect engagement.
Yeah, yes. And these just spatial kind of puzzles are just like incredible, and I love the design team.
Now it feels like a set. Like now it feels like, you know, you would be breaking the set if you don't have all
exactly.
Of the,
but you can also pick up those two games with Verdant if you would like to in the pledge manager. I believe that there is a kind of a Kickstarter exclusive by way of, I think it's about 16 kind of new cards that are only going to come with the Kickstarter. But also I really like that this is super well priced. I think it's about $60 including postage, which is a really good deal. And I've always found their games to be a good deal and really high production value as well. So
this another great thing to like introduce non-gamers. It's very accessible.
100%. You know, I've got colleagues that are just plank, friends that are plant crazy who would love this game and probably love to tell us all about the different types of plants that they have and which ones they have in their house. Probably all of the 160.
We have a friend that we had a catch up with recently, and we hadn't seen his house, and so we're doing a FaceTime catch up, and he was showing us the plants, and he loves plants. It's like a jungle in his apartment. Mm-hmm. It's just like there's just plants and greenery everywhere. He would love this game.
He had a collection of carnivorous plants, which he chose to put next to his bed, which was interesting choice.
Yeah,
and kind of terrifying. But anyway, that is neither here nor there. Mm-hmm. That is our number three, Verdant.
And now for our number two. Our number two is a game called Artisans of Splendent Vale. This is going to be another epic campaign that, well, actually this one plays 2 to 4 players, which I'm surprised by, because often this type of game cooperative, we usually have a solo mode, and I think I would really struggle. I will definitely struggle to get Amy.
You've probably seen our scores on the screen by now, but I gave it a 6 and Maggie gave it a 9, so quite a big gap.
I'm surprised by the 6. I you know, that to me says that you would humor it.
I'd humor. Oh, absolutely, yeah. I'd humor it.
That's good. But in Splendent, in Artisans of Splendent Vale, we are all playing as different artisans in this magical land, beautiful range of characters, so diverse, and we are all going, well, it's I don't actually know a lot about the story, because a lot of it you're going to be uncovering. Like, that's the whole point. One of the things that I did see that I'm going to absolutely love is there are stickers.
Oh,
and so
stickers,
you're going to be customizing your character along the way as you're collecting different things. And so it is kind of legacy style, because you are there are elements that are going to be permanently changing, and things like the stickers, again, permanently changing, but they will have recharge packs as well.
Yeah.
In terms of how it plays, you've got this central book, and that's where you kind of, that's the land, and that's where we're going to be playing a lot of things, or the story, or where the story will unfold. And then there's going to obviously be cards that representing different artifacts or elements or things that you're going to be discovering and using. So that's sort of probably as far as we'd be able to go in terms of...
I really like, the sticker element is really unique and totally fun, and I wish more games did it.
I know!
Because you have each character has, I think it's like almost like a vision board of things that they collect, but also if you go into battle and you get a scar, then you can get a sticker that has a scar on it.
That's cool.
And so then that, you know, character is a permanent, you know, you kind of a memory of what's happened along the journey.
Yeah.
I thought it was really interesting that instead of having a central storybook, actually each character has their own like little novel about how that character is going to grow and change. And I really liked, you know, the diverse set of characters is incredible, but also the fact that it really spoke to like who they were and what they were motivated by and what they cared about. And I thought that was like a glimpse into probably the writing that's sitting behind this. I should say that this game is designed by Nikki Valens, and they obviously have a huge history of creating these mammoth, exciting games that people love, like Quirky Circuits, for example, but also scary games that I won't touch, like Mansions of Madness and Arkham Horror as well. And so obviously a lot of thought has gone into the way that these characters are developed throughout the story. Yeah. I had a higher rating to begin with. The more that I read about how the game actually comes together, it is very narrative driven. Probably
too much reading for your liking.
There's a lot of reading, a lot of, I think it feels like a game where you want to immerse yourself in this experience and just be present with the different characters and like just go on an adventure together.
Yeah.
And there's something really like beautiful about that. I know you would love it.
Yes.
But also it's interesting that there's no like natural save point. I believe there's days where you can kind of stop playing at the end of a day, but really the game just kind of continues and you just pause wherever you like because it's like this one continuous adventure.
Yeah.
For me, I'm very objective driven, let's be honest. So
I have a start point and an end point and that's it. And then we start again. We do it again and we see who did it best.
But I think that with the right company, you know, I can see some of our friends who would really love this adventure. Yeah. And so I would be in on that.
I mean, it looks beautiful, like the artwork and all of it. Yeah.
In terms of backing, it's not going to be sold in distribution. So if you do want this game, either get it through the Kickstarter or you're going to have to get it through Renegade Games directly, I believe. I think that for the value, I think it's a little bit more to get the game with a recharge pack. But if you intend on selling the game on or giving it to family or friends so that they can play through it afterwards, I would definitely recommend getting that that recharge pack. And also plushies.
Oh, the plushies.
Super cute. I like, can every game come with plushies?
I can never have too many plushies.
Yeah, and I'm like the winged cat for me. That's my favorite plushie. So if I had to get one, that's the one I would probably get. But
that's so cute.
So cute. Mm. And the whole game is just really cute and beautifully illustrated as well. So
magical as can be.
That is our number two, Artisans of Splendent Vale. And our number one game for the fortnight. Number one is Scandalo. And if you know how much of a fan of awkward guests that I am, you would probably guess that this would be our number one. I was really surprised by how much Maggie actually got into the game Scandalo because typically you are not a huge fan of deduction in general, but also awkward guests is probably much lower in your ranking, overall ranking, than it would be for me.
Humor it, but it's not like, I can't wait to play awkward guests again. Yeah. But it's just, and again, it's a genre thing for me. Like,
but you really enjoyed this deduction puzzle and it's quite challenging and you beat me on numerous times, so that probably helps. But Scandalo is a deduction game based on this brilliant deck system that Megacorp and Games have developed, where you will be piecing together the case at the beginning of the game and then using those cards to mark things off a player sheet to deduce what's happening. In this particular game, you are going to be trying to work out what scandal is going to be released about a celebrity, which celebrity, and who helped them with this scandal, and which newspaper is going to break the story. If you want to understand more about the gameplay and how you deduce this, kind of all the pieces of this puzzle, go and check out our full Kickstarter preview, which is on the campaign page, and I'll link to it above. But broadly speaking, you are trying to race each other, and you are trying to you'll be exchanging pieces of information by way of cards in this game, and that creates an interesting tension, like an awkward guess, where you are thinking about whether you want to withhold pieces of information or trade them.
I never withhold. I'm like, oh yeah, here's some information.
I'll like withhold one really good card or something like that, just to hold you back a little bit. But this game is, I would say, harder than Awkward Guess, and in that it requires you to make more leaps of deduction. It requires you to kind of use your brain a little bit more than Awkward Guess. Awkward Guess is, there's a tiny bit of deduction, but it's mostly just crossing things off for the puzzle.
Yeah, I actually find this one easier myself.
Oh, that's interesting.
And I think it's because this one obviously has a lot more color as well throughout the whole thing, and everything is sort of has color coding alongside it, and that's one of the things that I really struggle with Awkward Guess, because it's very monochrome.
But I found I think the puzzle is harder though. I think that you just got more confused with Awkward Guess because of the lying staff and all of that kind of thing. So maybe it was just hard in a confusing way.
Yes.
Whereas this one is hard in a, like,
the core puzzle way.
Search for Planet X kind of way, where you're trying to like piece together what are the possible combinations on your player sheet rather than just being told what's possible and not possible. So Scandalo, obviously, we love this game. It is a great follow-up to Awkward Guess. In terms of backing it, there are many different levels that you can back it at. I think the base game is actually where it's at. The price is really good on that. The pricing is a little high to Australia. I think it's like $31 or something. It was $31 US. Mm-hmm. So that's quite expensive, but the game itself is not highly priced. Yeah. It was also really hard to find a copy of Awkward Guess in many places around the world after the campaign. Mm-hmm. So that is something else to bear in mind. The other thing is there is an option to get like a book that gives you a bit mm-hmm. more flavor text about the characters. And interestingly, when we were playing this game, we kind of wanted that flavor text a little bit. Because
yeah, sometimes I was like, I want to know more yeah. about this scandal or this thing. Yeah, because
the whole game is focused on the celebrities and what they could or couldn't have done. Mm-hmm. It would be interesting to have a bit more background on those characters.
You're on the theme.
But then I was going to say, having said that, I never once used the book that I got with Awkward Guest.
Yeah, but the book with Awkward Guest, if I'm remembering correctly, was more around the artwork. So it wasn't actually giving you... Mm. Oh, maybe it was giving you a little bit of information.
No, there was a bit of information.
But I remember it mostly as like, oh, yeah, this is more of that beautiful artwork. Even though it's still all monochrome and I love color.
No, there was information about the characters, right. But it's also like a Kickstarter exclusive. So yeah. I personally, I would just go for the base game. But having said that, I do think the characters and like, because only certain types of characters can do certain types of scandals, mm-hmm. I think the flavor text would be more interesting.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Because it's like, this person is a sports person, and you can kind of get that from the player board, but yeah. not a lot of that.
I think it would probably flesh them out a little bit, because at no point did I find, like, it was fun to bring the puzzle together and go, oh, okay, this is, but no point was like, oh my goodness, I can't believe Fred did this. Or like, there was no personal investment in the characters themselves mm-hmm. beyond just like, oh yeah, making the connection. This is the combo and that's the case mm-hmm. sort of thing. I should actually also say that this plays great at a two-player count.
It does, yeah.
Which you wouldn't be able to really do with Awkward Guess.
I still think it would be better at a higher player yeah. count, because there's more exchange of more yes, information. Of course, but yeah. the way that they have, kind of increased the card count in your hand and like made it such that you are kind of discarding away from the game with yeah. a two-player. I think they've probably worked a bit harder on that. Yeah. And yeah, it's still, because you're doing more deduction, it's more of a competition
yeah.
rather than just trying to collect all the information. Yeah. So
there's also going to be a solo mode, which I haven't had a chance to play yet, because it's going to be against, like, you're using yeah. the app for it. And I love that there's scalable difficulty in terms of the cases. So it's like you can kind of gauge it based on who you're playing with. And mm-hmm. if I'm playing it solo, then I'm going to be more comfortable kind of cranking up the difficulty or when we're playing together. But if we're introducing non-gamers or people who are kind of fairly new, at that time of the evening where there's not that much brain power going, so you don't want something that's too difficult, then you can kind of scale it back. Hmm. Yeah. That's cool.
So that is Scandalo, one that I would have backed without seeing the campaign. Yeah. I'm so excited. We do have a prototype copy, which I will be clinging on to. but if I didn't, we'd be backing it immediately. So that is a back from us. So this fortnight, we have backed at least our top five.
Wow.
Which is an expensive fortnight. But we didn't back anything last fortnight. So
it sort of evens out.
We're doing okay overall. But yeah, it looks like Kickstarter season is well and truly back on again.
Oh my goodness.
So, if you are down in the comments, let us know what you've backed this fortnight out of the ones that we've spoken about or any others that we didn't speak about. Please hit like and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, and we'll be back in 2 more weeks spending much more money. But otherwise, bye for now.
Bye.